should be here. Today we have a guest lecture from Morten Marquard from DCR Solutions. I already told you a few things about DCR graphs, and I know Morten from, I guess, 2015 Innsbruck, hybrid process technologies in the financial sector was your presentation then. Still at Xformatics, and now the company is really big. And Morten, you have the stage.
Thank you, Johannes. Yes, and let me just go back to Innsbruck, because that was a really, really good meeting. You know, I was sitting in a meeting and then somebody was presenting DCR, and I didn't know Johannes at that time. I found that quite amazing that you create a technology and then somebody embraces it, but you didn't really know who it was. And of course, I know there are a lot of researchers. I'm not a researcher myself, so you probably got it from them. You talked to Thomas and Søren and Thijs, I presume, but you know, that was a good experience. So thanks for that. And thanks for inviting me today. And I was asked to talk a little about the challenges and the advantages of taking a business process management and put it into production, into a system. And I normally say this way, in fact, only a very few people has done this. Everybody's talking about business process management, but I would argue that very few people actually take the last step and take the model and put it into an IT system and into production, because that typically requires a lot of manual programming, because very, very few models can actually be sort of the foundation of a digital system. And what we came up with DCR graphs is a different way of, it's a different methodology from BPMN to actually describe processes. And one of the benefits is that once you describe the model, you don't need to code anything. So it's a no code platform. And it means that we can basically give the ownership of the business back to the business. I'm sort of an old guy, I've been in this industry for many, many years. And everybody's always talked about that there's a big bridge from IT to business. And for the last 30 years I've been in the industry, the bridge has only been wider. It hasn't been more narrow. So, you know, we have to start making it more narrow again. And I think DCR is a potential technology that can actually revolutionize the way we sort of set up IT systems and the way we leverage IT technologies in companies. So the problem The problem with current sort of solutions are that they are in reality not digital. What you typically do, you create a model, but the model is mostly an image that you put on the wall, if you're lucky. You might also put it into a binder, you might put it into an image in a computer and say, this is what people have to do. But so I would argue it's not truly digital. I normally use the word, it's like CD-ROM digitization. I got a CD-ROM player with music on in 1985. And you could start wondering, did the music industry became digital in 1985? Because at that time the media was digital, but it didn't work in a digital way, because it was only the delivery of the sort of music to the CD-ROM that was digital. The rest was still analog. And I would argue that most of the things we're doing in IT today is what I call CD-ROM digitization. It's not truly digital, because the whole value chain is not digital. It's only part of it. The second problem with the current process is that it's very, very expensive to set it up, because you have to find what people often refer to as the happy path or the perfect path or the golden path. And in reality, it often does not exist. So then you have to massage your organization. You have to train your employees to behave in a certain manner to make things work. That is extremely expensive. And probably the worst thing about it is that I always argue that the perfect process does not exist. And the argument is very simple. If the perfect process existed, innovation would not be needed. Innovation wouldn't exist. And people keep on innovation, keep on making new things. So the perfect process will not be that are perfect today will not be perfect tomorrow. So do not aim for the perfect, but aim for supporting change, because that's more important. And finally, even if you was possible to describe the process, find what people refer to the golden path, implementing it in an IT system is very expensive. Typically it takes 12 to 18 months, probably requires hundreds of programmers to do it. And we have a very good experience with this in Denmark, where we have a lot of big IT projects run by government, paid by the taxpayers. Our pockets are very deep. We have a high tax, so So people just pay, and it is extremely expensive. And the problem with the approach is that, you know, it takes a long time. And the problem, every time we get this system, we often have these governmental scandals because the system was expensive. It doesn't fulfill the need of the users. So, you know, we have to sort of bridge that. And that problem comes up again and again. And of course, you can imagine sort of this is what DCR basically solves. And I think what's most important about DCR is that you can continuously improve your processes when you use DCR. And we have some very good case stories about that. I don't have that much time, so can't dig into it, but I can send more information if people are interested in it, because we have real life stories about it. So just to sum up, that basically what the DCR described is that you say everything that is not explicitly forbidden is allowed. And the benefit of that is that you basically just describe the rules, and then based on all these rules, you can do everything you like. I know for management, sometimes that is a little scary, but if you then tell them, but I'm sure that all the rules are adhered to, so you could be 100% compliant, but people can work in many different ways. So this is what the declarative models are about. The traditional models, the BPMN-based models, you basically say everything that is not explicitly described is disallowed. And I sometimes use the sort of the GPS or the car analogy. So, you know, if you have to go from one city in the car to another, you know, the Google Maps could make you a route, and then you'd start driving on that route. Once you have that process, any deviation to say put on gas to the car will be an exception in BPMN terminology. And I'm always saying that if putting gas on a car, or electricity, hopefully in the future, on a car is an exception, then you have a bad model, because you cannot live an exception that happened weekly. That's not an exception, that is part of life. So you have to have a model that describes this, because else everybody's doing exceptions all the time, and then you lose the focus on the value of the process. So, you know, you have to have very flexible processes, because that's what people are needing in the real life. Very briefly, the customers, we are mostly in the governmental and the municipality areas, and mostly in Denmark. We have, as you can see here, Kommune de Genova is actually starting to use the technology for building permits, making building permits. And we also have a few private companies on the list here, like Maymox. So I think in total, we're saying approximately 30 customers are using the technology as of today. One of the founders of DCR, Thomas Hillebrand, who's now a professor at University of Copenhagen, he sits on our advisory board. And basically what he says is that, well, despite that Denmark is sometimes, you know, as Danes, we are very proud that we like to say we're number one. We might win the European championship in soccer. I would say probably not. But, you know, as a small country, you tend to sort of say, we're pretty good. But I think it's fair to say we are probably fairly good at doing digitization in government. It's very, very expensive. But despite that fact, that if you really look at the level of what we're doing, we are still having enormous amount of problem. If you look at any municipality in Denmark and ask what is the law compliance, you actually get law compliance percentages of 0.something. It's like, how can you have a government sort of institution that doesn't adhere to the law in less than 1% of the time? It's like, and even we have from, there are complaints of municipality decisions. If people complain, approximately half of the complaints get sort of a yes, this is wrong, and the case has to be worked through again. So, you know, if half of what a municipality or government institution is doing is wrong, it talks about we have a big problem. So, you know, how do we solve that? And the problem is the laws are complex, the rules are complex, and you have to adhere to all that. And people are trying to find straight through processes to it. It doesn't exist. But then they try to follow these processes, and that leads to so many sort of things not following in the law that you get in trouble. And this is where we are today. So we have to find new ways to make IT system. And this is basically what DCR is. It's like an AI technology that can support the complex world and find new patterns even when things change, because they will eventually change. So what we do is basically we can take a law And we have looked at different laws in Denmark. We have looked at municipality law that could be childcare and protection. It could be elder care, it could be building permits. We look at this law. So this is law coming from the government, potentially with sort of a recommendation on how you should interpret the law. And then you basically take this law and you mark it up with different colors. We have a tool for that called the highlighter tool. This is what I want to show here on the left. When you highlight the elements of the law, you highlight the roles, that is sort of who are participating in this law. So you have the citizen, you have the caseworker, you might have a manager. So these are the roles. Then you talk about what are the activities, that is, what are you doing? You have to review something, the citizen has to submit something, somebody have to approve something, and somebody might have to pay out some benefits, right? So these are the activities. And these are the two elements you are firstly sort of taking out of the law text. The last thing are the rules saying you cannot submit benefit to the employee before a rule has been made. And the rule, of course, must be approved or the approval rule must be chosen or the outcome of approval has to be chosen. So these are the rules. And the interesting part is that this is actually part of the law. It is described in the law. So you can actually take the law and create a model. When you do that, you actually get an IT system that basically guides you through what you should do, but not in a very rigid manner. It is not a decision tree. We call it a decision graph. So it is comparable to a decision tree, but it is much more flexible. You can go back and you can change your mind. You can have more decisions at one point in time. No, I don't want to make that decision now. I want to make the second decision. But it does the same thing, but there's a more flexibility to it. And basically, so we can take this step here from the model in the center. Once that is created, we basically have this IT system. And this IT system we put into other vendors' IT systems. And that's how we go to market. So we don't actually deliver an IT system. We basically move into other IT systems because it turns out to be fairly simple to implement these type of systems in existing systems. And we are looking to systems that you probably know, like SAP, ServiceNow, and Salesforce, to do the same thing. So we have customers here in Denmark that are asking us, can this be implemented in these type of systems? And we haven't done it yet. We are talking to them and investigating how we can do it. But the point is that the capability of delivering sort of task lists and decision points can actually be put into any IT system. And it's quite simple to do. And this is something. This is how we get to the market. We don't want to sort of replace SAP. That would be fairly unrealistic, if you ask me. And I don't think it's even worth trying because, you know, they are solving so many problems already that we would then have also to solve. Doesn't make any sense from my perspective. So just talking briefly about the specific challenges and the advantages, when you take these systems and put it into any sort of organization. And one organization we work quite a lot with is the Suderø municipality. It's a small Danish municipality of 50,000 inhabitants. And they are looking for in what they call the childcare and protection department. This is if something goes wrong with kids in general, the municipality have to take care of the kids and ultimately remove them from the parents if it's really, really bad, of course. And we have a law called the service law, which basically outline all these rules. And what you can do is that you can actually take these rules and basically mark them up, and you actually get a meaningful system that ensures that you're law compliant. So they started with the law text, and we found out that you can actually make an IT system, and it's meaningful for the social workers to actually work with such a system. And I think what the social workers are not very fond of IT system. I can guarantee you that. And so we were very, very pleased that one of the social workers said that this system is like a companion. It helps me remembering important tasks and important things to do and helps me following the law. And I think if IT can be an assistant, I don't believe that IT should overtake what the social worker should do and basically have straightforward processes with no manual interaction. But I think if a system can be a companion, be your companion, that's actually pretty good. Maybe later in some years, we can do it even better. But I think the aim of being a companion to any worker in a government institution or any worker in a private company, then you're pretty well off. And I think we have achieved that. We have some case studies about it. And one of the challenges that you face when you talk about processes is that you probably will ask you, what is the process? And if you start asking that question, you will get many, many different answers. Because some people say the process is the process description. Some people say it's a flow. Some people say it's the rules. And it's probably many of these things combined together is the process. And then when you then ask what is the specifics of this, any particular process, you might actually get many, many different answers and many different paths through the system. And this is what we have to observe, that people are different. So, you know, what you can do is that, so your ability to align the organization and create common grounds is quite easy with DCR, because what we are trying to do, we don't try to find this golden path, the path every employee should follow to make everything works. What we're trying to do is to say, can we agree on who participates, what do they do, what are the rules? And if we can agree on that, we have a process. And that is actually much more easy than find the golden path. Eventually, once we've done that, we might mine and find out later on, 40% of the time people take this path. Then we found the golden path from not from asking people, but from observing how they work. And I would argue that is probably a more valid golden process than when you ask people. So, you know, so DCR can actually help you aligning and finding, aligning people to understand what the process is about. One of the advantages, of course, is that once you have the process in place in an IT system, you can monitor it. So when you can monitor it, you can find bottlenecks, you can find issues very, very easily. And finally, when you change the process, you can basically get feedback from people. Say, and we have this example from Studios, one where one of the case workers came and said, well, we need to change the process for this reason. And we could easily incorporate that into the system. So, you know, the next day that process change was in place. And that gave the organization sort of, they felt that they were heard, because, you know, their suggestion to process improvement was basically put into the process and getting online and into a realized system the day after. So, you know, so they then the employees get more motivated and more sort of into the system. So I'm going to skip this one as I don't have too much time, but I will share the slides with you. But because I would just briefly like to show you how it looks, just sort of a few screenshots from what we're doing. So this is basically coming from a law text. So you're saying this is in Danish, but could have been in any language in principle. And what you do is that you basically highlight different types. So I said the roles, the activities, and the rules. You can see they're green for roles, blue for activities, and orange for rules. And there's a link between this object here on the right, as well as this text that is highlighted over here. So I can basically find out how did, not only can I create the model, because that's the easy part, but the challenge for many people when you talk about compliance is that then you ask, so this IT system that you invested a lot of money in, is that compliant? And then people say yes. And then you ask the second question, okay, please document that. And then it gets very, very quiet often because they don't know how do we document compliance. What we can do is we can say we can document compliance because we have found the things. This is how we interpret the law. And of course, any interpretation can, or we could probably even put it stronger, any interpretation will have errors in it. Some people might have interpreted this wrongly, but then we can change it. So when I change the interpretation of the law, I will change the system. And this is what we would like to be able to do so we can check that the model we make actually follows the law. And the law here can be in very general. It can be not only the law, it can also be laws and sort of more financial regulation, specific process description. And you can have different layers of the law text, sort of you can have different layers of text in the system. So this is partly how it looks. What you can also do and talk about this is the diversity of what we have observed. From Copenhagen University, they had a tenure track process they would like to look at. And we talked to the HR department. They said, we have a Word document describing the process. It's straight through and it's very, very simple. And then we asked people, I think three different people, to basically give some examples of how the process could execute, so draw the flow. And then we mined it and found out that, well, people don't interpret it exactly the same way. And the point is that HR didn't understand this because they said, but how can this happen? Because the process is very linear and very simple. But the point is that people look at the data and then they sort of interpret it sometimes differently. And what you can basically see here is that they basically swapped a few of the activities, the sequence of it. And the point is that happens quite a lot. And you could argue that, well, if it doesn't matter, we can just make one sequence sort of the way we should do it. But the problem with that is that will be inefficient no matter what you do. So, you know, if things are not in sequence, if there is no sequence, don't force a sequence. But once you do that, you have a diversity. That means that when you look at it, it's sometimes hard to basically understand what's going on. That's where you have to say, but the reason we know this works is that we have mined the rules, or we basically looked at the rules. We know all the rules has been adhered to in the process. That's fine. And we could monitor rule violations to find out if people are not doing things as they should do. And I normally put this one because this is something in the Lean and Six Sigma community. They talk about these straight-through processes. And I basically argue they do not exist. It's probably putting it a little too far, but I think it's an important point to make because people expect these things to exist, but I strongly doubt that they do in reality exist. There is always variation. The way you could look at it is that you can just look at the variation is these yellow stickers sitting on people's desk. Are people sending many emails or they writing many documents? That are indicators that it is not as straight through as you thought because they are doing other things. And this is one of the problem. And I actually heard Professor Hayo Reyes talking about process mining. And he said, it's interesting when you look at the data from the logs, many events are recorded Friday afternoon. And it's like an indicator that people do the work and then they go into the system and then they report what they did afterwards. The problem is that it might look as straight through because that's how they report it in the system, probably because they cannot report anything but the straight through. And then management and consultants are happy and say, see, straight through processes happens. But in reality, what happens is that people just do the work as they do, and then they report it afterwards. And that means you cannot trust process mining because the logs doesn't reflect the reality. And at worst is that people don't use the IT system. They use these yellow stickers. So if they get sick on Thursday, and they're doing a case over the week, you know, nobody else can take over because nobody knows where it is because it's not locked in the system. Then of course, as the last thing you can monitor either how often do the cases fall through the system, or you can analyze and say, are there any typical path? And what we're showing here is basically the typical path as well as how long time elapsed from last activity. And we can look both at delay, I can look at delay from the previous activity, but in DCR, we also have this ability to talk about something that you must do. So I know how long time elapsed since you had to do this, since it became an obligation. Because you know you can do many things in life, but when once something becomes an obligation, how fast do you sort of capture that one? It might be somebody else did something and now I can continue, now I must continue doing this. So you know, looking at obligations from it become an obligation till it get executed is actually more interesting than just looking at the elapsed time, because that's, you know, you could be waiting on third parties. So you know, you can wait for long times. If you send a case to say the citizen to ask for something, a long time can happen there, but that should not affect your response time. And that's quite important. So the message to you is basically as people in business school working with processes is that you should embrace the complexity of the world and not aim for the simplicity because it doesn't exist. And I think if IT does not make the reality more complex, because IT has a tendency to make the reality more complex than it is, and that should not happen. But if we can not make it worse, we're pretty well off, but making it simple, I don't believe that's possible. So thank you, I'll just stop sharing here. And I don't know if there are questions or comments.
Yeah, I got a question. Have you ever considered working with law students doing some like the work they are doing just to mine their like to track their decisions by doing some work for the university? Like yes. Just give them 5 euros an hour for learning and just track how they are thinking the law is done with your tool?
Yes, and we got fund for a project. We just ran the project this spring with students from the law school. We have the office in Copenhagen University. The law department is just below us. So okay. That was very, very easy. So yes, we did a study. There will be out a report probably in the fall. But the preliminary results is actually quite interesting. The law students tells us, why don't we do law in this way? Because not only do we get a digital law, but they also said they understand the law much better after they have mapped it. And I totally agree with them. So, you know, hearing for them. So yes, we did that. It's a perfect idea. So, you know, if you have any more ideas or comments, that would be very much appreciated. But Johannes, please remember that I should share the results with you guys. That's
of course. Thank you.
Yeah. Very good question indeed.
Any other questions? Then I have one, as we have many business informatics students here that will apply some sort of process modeling technique. What do you think is the biggest pitfall they can fall into while implementing their processes?
I didn't understand. What is the biggest what, sorry?
The biggest pitfall challenge. What do you think they should do better than our generation?
You know, this is what I say, they embrace the complexity. You know, do not look for simplicity. I think everybody, you know, tends to do it. And even, you know, I also do it. You know, we did a big process mining exercise over the last few weeks, and we kept on looking for the simplicity. There must be a simple model. And we just kept on looking for it. And then I realized that if the law text is 100,000 pages, expecting a model of ABC is quite naive. But this is at least what my generation expects. There must be a simple way to do it. It doesn't exist. But the point is that what I tried to say before, if IT doesn't make the 100,000 pages more worse than 100,000 pages, then we are okay. We cannot solve the problem of 100,000 pages. That is reality. But do not make it worse. And that's something that IT tends to do. They invent their own concepts and their own models. And you can look at BPMN, and I normally say BPMN makes things worse, because every time you add something into the model, you typically make it double the size. So you don't have to add a lot of things until you get a model that is completely unmanageable. And that is a problem. So, you know, BPMN, from my perspective, is bad because the technology it works pretty well as long as you have 5 to 7 activities. This is why business consultants from Accenture or McKinsey, if you look at the slides, they always have 5 boxes, right? Because they try to put the world into 5 boxes, which makes sense because that's how we can comprehend as humans. But limiting it, when you describe it in an IT system, to these 5 boxes is probably not a good idea. So don't expect that you can make things simple. It doesn't exist. So just go for the complexity and help us supporting it, because it's something we need.
Okay, then thank you for the presentation. For the students, I'll switch to German in sure. The next few seconds. Thank you, Morten, for participating. I hope to see you next term as well.
Yeah, same to you. Thanks. Cheers. Bye.
So.